Oh, this is going to be interesting. That's... Oh. But for those of you who don't know, we have Bob here. He comes from the net. Hi, Bob.
Hi, Ned.
Oh, that's right. I have to be Ben Stein. No giggling, no smirking, no shots. I have clear eyes. Yes. I apologize if I show any human emotions. I am working on perfecting this. Okay, moving on. Say what?
That Bueller.
Yeah.
Bueller.
I have a personality. I get emotional. I have to be... Anyways, B. Ben Stein. I have a note here. It's a little sticky. It says B. Ben Stein. I need a little beach ball where I can pour the water on it and all the red disappears, but I'm not giving away my money.
Now, seeing how you're a KDE person, now would that be a sticky widget, or would that just be like a piece of paper and a sticky?
I'm not telling. Okay. I'm not sure what of this, if any, is remotely... It's ridiculously old news at this point about the whole T-Mobile, what the effedness...
What's there to go over? Yep, Justice Department doesn't like mobile again. That's pretty much what it boils down to.
Well, and they're not quite mobile yet, but they're working towards it just as hard as they currently can. I'm gonna laugh if they have to stick to their contract, because AT&T's contract, and I was wrong, apparently it is $6 billion. Effectively, what this decision from the Justice Department means, if AT&T can't get it overturned, is they're supposed to write T-Mobile a check for $6 billion and let all T-Mobile customers roam free of charge on the AT&T network.
Now, the question is that voice and data also, though? Or is it just voice?
It's supposed to be roaming, and it's voice and data, but due to the hardware limitation, T-Mobile handsets would have a hard time using the AT&T 3G or 4G data because they use different technology. They use different antennas.
Yeah, I was going to say, because one uses HSPA Plus, and the other uses LTE and something else, GSM or whatever. Not GSM, but...
Yeah, however, if they are forced to do that and that gets upheld, I see in the near future T-Mobile importing a lot of AT&T bandwidth Qualcomm phones. Don't you?
Absolutely.
I mean, because they make those phones, and some of the Android phones are sold overseas Qualcomm. T-Mobile just chooses not to stock those because they cost a little more.
Oh, God. Pay more money for an unlocked phone? What?
Well, no, it's not that. I'm sure they'd still be locked, but it's if your phone's locked and it's only available on your network, why are you going to stock the Qualcomm phone that can be taken to your competition? If however, T-Mobile gets access to the AT&T network as part of this federal breakup, which I'm rooting for, then it would be in T-Mobile's best interest to stock their Qualcomm phones that handle all four bandwidths. Excuse me, all four antennas, spectrums.
Also true. Be one hell of a way for T-Mobile to get back into the, oh, hey, we're going to stop losing customers game.
Well, what that would mean is due to AT&T being unable to buy T-Mobile, T-Mobile phones would now work.
I was going to say, once you get outside of populated areas, T-Mobile is, yeah.
But they wouldn't in, and I've been in the middle of populated areas. I told you the story about T-Mobile, like, driving me off the road, literally.
Oh, so true.
Okay. I don't know what else we can say on that. We covered Applegate 2.0, or is it Applegate 3.0 at this point? There's been too many Applegates to keep track. We had Applegate with the...
That was AntennaGate.
Yeah, okay. And we had AntennaGate. Then we had the Applegate. Then we had the Steve Jobs doesn't work Applegate. Then we had the... Congress fixing to investigate them over antenna gate Applegate. And we had the Apple stock Applegate, and then we had the MacBook Pros don't work right Applegate, and now we have the Apple Gestapo Applegate.
What are you talking about? Apple's perfect. They don't do anything wrong.
What is that?
That would be my Ubuntu machine.
Okay. You can tell how long it's been since I've booted up Ubuntu.
I'm used to it.
If somebody would take Ubuntu and put in the time, effort, and energy to completely redo it and make it a good KDE distro, not Kubuntu. Kubuntu is not a good KDE distro.
Oh, I agree to that.
And I haven't... I mean, really, Ubuntu makes great GNOME or GNOME-like distros. It doesn't really make a good KDE distro because of the amount of... You just basically have to redo too many things. You can, but it's... The Ubuntu's equivalent of a control panel. It's just it's geared towards the GNOME mindset. Everything by default is set up that way. You'd have to give it an entire redo.
I agree. It'd be like, I don't know if you've ever tried installing sudo apt getting KDE or Kubuntu desktop. So you get all the KDE stuff. It's a horrible broken mess if you try to do that on top of GNOME.
Yeah, no, that doesn't really work right either. But my favorite distro PC has the same problem. They make Gator, which is Gator is to PC Lin what Kubuntu is to Ubuntu.
Yeah.
It is the GNOME environment, but it's the GNOME environment on a distro that designed everything for the way you do things in KDE. And you're in a bit of a boxing match there the whole time. You're just going to be.
Well, it's like, it's been a while, but the last time I tried PC Lin was the Enlightenment respin of it. And I liked it. I'm not a fan of some of the way they alter some of the stuff, I guess. It's very reminiscent of KDE in that regard.
Yeah. Well, it's the same thing with X-Face or whatever the heck you want to call it.
Yeah, or XFCE or...
Yeah, I call it X-Face, but yeah, XFCE.
Yeah, you don't want to piss off the GTK2 fanboys, God forbid.
Oh, heaven forbid. You know what, on that note, if we don't want to piss people off, I shouldn't be calling it GNOME. GNOME.
I could care less. Navy conventions don't matter to me when it
comes. Oh, I know. I'm sure the G is silent. People will come out of the woodwork. I have gotta get that soundbite of Gary the GNOME saying GNOME and just play that every time I want to say GNOME. Just go GNOME. Gnash Gnome. How did we get off on that from Apple?
You heard my Ubuntu machine boot up.
Okay. Okay.
Hey, PC is not just Windows.
Yeah, somebody, there was finally other people saying that in the comments now. I noticed that. Like, somebody was arguing with somebody in the comments the other day saying, PC equals personal computer, not Windows. I was like, yes, they get it!
Some could even argue that a Mac is a PC.
Yeah, that was what they were arguing, actually.
And I actually agree with that argument that Mac is a PC because it's your personal computing preference.
Well, and some of the recent decisions Apple has made have made it clear that they do not want to be in any way, shape, or form an enterprise or business system.
Not yet, anyway. Unfortunately, just look at what happened with RIM. They were more or less pushed in the consumer market. Before they, when they focused on 99% of the time, they focused on the enterprise. That was their stick.
Well, and the diehard enterprise people are still going to want that, but I know this firsthand because I know those diehard enterprise people. The whole industry is suffering a change-up right now, and that is the baby boomers are retiring, and the young guns are taking over, and the young guns... basically, there's the hallmark companies have been gobbled up and bought, and the first thing they did when they got gobbled up and bought was fire all their middle managers, so as the old-timers are aging out and retiring, you know, all the baby boomers, there is no middle management people who know how things have been done for 20 to 30 years and why we use all this enterprise stuff for security and yon and so forth. So it's, we're going straight from the baby boomers, no, I am not going to have this gaping, big, wide hole in our corporate structure, to the 18 to 24-year-olds that they hired as interns who are now in charge of things, who go, I have an iPhone. It's cool. Oh, we don't need encrypted email or security or firewalls or any of that stuff. We just need it cool. See how cool it is? I push the button and it does things.
It's like a story someone told me about someone needed, you know, they essentially ran a wedding shop, you know, on their back end. They needed that one Exchange server because someone wanted a Blackberry.
Well, and that's one of the weaknesses of Blackberry's system. I've been saying for years Blackberry should figure out a way to add an encryption layer on that bit where you have a Blackberry app that can do with that backend, but doesn't need to be a Blackberry device. Because as long as you encrypt it to the hardware, so the administrator goes in and adds the individual hardware by MAC address restriction, that's still a pretty dang secure system. And it's Blackberry is set up to license and basically own that industry if they're smart. If they wait too long, we're going to be talking about Blackberry the same way we do IBM and now HP.
Bad HP. Bad. Morons.
Oh, wait. No laughing. Laughing bad. I need like a shock collar. Every time I laugh, it shocks me or something. It's like I need compulsion therapy or something.
We'll just get you one of those dog collars that with the invisible fence, and just put the invisible fence really close, so when you start laughing, you get shocked.
I think they make ones that are like to teach them not to bark, so we'd have to calibrate it for laughs or something. And then, and y'all would see me here going... It's like, well, he's just training himself not to laugh. And then, of course, it wouldn't know the difference. Y'all would laugh like crazy, and then I'd get shocked to death.
All the more reason.
Oh, that's kind. That's really kind there.
Hey, I never said I was nice.
Okay. Apple's not the only one who screwed up. Did we want to say anything else on Apple? We kept getting off of it. I think it's kind of been said to death, and we covered it on iWorld, so.
It's Apple. React. It could be a publicity stunt. It could be blah, blah, blah.
I said that in iWorld. I thought it might be a publicity stunt.
Personally, I think the last one was pretty much a publicity stunt, too, but that's just me.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, we're just going to have one website with photos but no specs. Okay, so you're going to dissect the prototype phone and not list out the specs?
I don't think they dissected it.
Well, they cracked it open anyway, I know that.
Okay. No, but they're not going to do a full teardown like they usually would. Anyways, moving on to the Microsoftian land. It turns out Microsoft is being sued.
Good.
Yeah. Do you even care why?
I'm assuming something for patents. Nowadays.
Actually, no. Of all the things to sue Microsoft for, it's a privacy concern.
You even the thing that they stick Google in every 5 seconds?
Exactly. Now they're sticking Microsoft with this. Microsoft is feeling left out, so it's a good thing they can now get some of those Google suits. You know, they're one of the companies alleging that Google has a monopoly, and that's why Bing isn't prospering.
Not Bing isn't prospering because, well, okay, it's not bad, but it's not that good.
The only thing Bing has done right is either because Microsoft can't figure out how or because they literally don't care. They are the easiest search engine to pull automated searches from. Like literally, I could throw 10,000 keywords at Bing and get the results for them and find out where a page I'm auditing is in 100 seconds. I can just go bum 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 and get them all and get the accurate ranks and get the links for them and so on. They're not Google, on the other hand, that takes me all day because I have to, you know, pretend to be a human being and do other things and yada yada. It's like we all still do it. We all know it's computer software, but And what I find hysterical about that is Yahoo, which is powered by the Bing engine, is also preventing automated pulls. But Bing.com doesn't. I can't figure that one out.
That's Yahoo for you, though.
Yeah.
I think they just fired the CEO again.
Well, Yahoo's well on its way to obscurity. I mean, it's for a while there, the Yahoo local stuff was creating slightly different results. But now the only reason Yahoo results are different is because Yahoo hasn't updated their server yet. So it's like maybe a 3-day lag.
See the tech giants fall is great sometimes.
Well, you know, when one giant falls, another 3 crop up that you've never heard of.
Evolve or die.
Yeah. Anyways, the allegation of all things is that Windows 7 smartphones track you.
Oh, no shit. All smartphones track you.
I know.
They have a built-in GPS. Of course, they're gonna...
When I see suits like this, I honestly wonder, how dumb are people? You mean your GPS transponder, you didn't know that was... Old cell phones have basically been a GPS or triangulation tracker for about the last decade. I mean, I'm trying to think. There are a few cell phones you could buy in 99 and 2000 that didn't have that in, but that was only because they were like last year or the year before's model. So, wow, your phone's tracking you. I don't like that they track me either. I'd prefer to be able to turn all that off, but you really can't. Oh, well. We have anything we want to say on that or move on to the next one?
It's no different than the iPhone. It's no different than the Android phones.
Are you...
Grow a brain. I'm an informed consumer. That's pretty much all I'm going to tell anybody.
Or any phone. I mean, I as a private citizen can track you anywhere you go by just pinging you text messages.
Yep.
It's like, bing, there he is. Bing, there he is. Bing, there she is. Ooh, there she is. It's like... Okay. The next one I find interesting... There's a growing divide in relation to Windows 8. And it's leading to a growing sentiment that Microsoft, and this is something I wish both Microsoft and Apple would do, and that is open their desktop shell environment so that if you don't like the stock way they did it, you are allowed to fix it for you. Because this is something power users would do, you know, either replace it with somebody else's entirely or, you know, sit there for a weekend and redo it. I don't see how that would hurt Microsoft or anyone to do that.
Yeah, I hear you. As someone who's tried the various, like, shell replacements, as they call them now, for Windows, it'd be great if we could, you know, customize our desktop. Not just move the menu bar around.
Yeah. I mean, you can do some augmentation in some cases, but you're still kind of stuck with the Windows shell. And it's like, no, it can be more. I can rebuild it. It can be better. It's,
in all honesty, that's why I like, KDE distros, and, if you're going in on that route, that's why I like some of those distros, is because it's like, okay, I don't like the way KDE does this. I'm just going to change everything.
Well, I say that's one of the great things about the way KDE works, since it's entirely widget-based like that. If you don't like the way it's set up, you can just create a new space and a new panel and kind of go as nuts as you want. Because every little piece of it is just, well, no, I think this should be here. I think that should be there. I mean, if I wanted to, I could have my desktop be my equivalent of a start menu in KDE, if I wanted to. I don't want it to be, but I could if I wanted to.
And, that's one of the things I find unfortunate. I do use Ubuntu and a lot of its derivatives. That's one of the things I kind of miss about the older LTS, 10.04 LTS. There's at least some type of customization to it.
Yeah. Well, we got to talking about, GNOME and all of that on Linux, Jordan was saying the extensions let you get all of that back. Is that not enough for you, or?
Yes and no. I'm just talking from a Unity use perspective here. I'm not talking about just like GNOME shell.
Okay.
Yeah, this is more of a Ubuntu specific in it.
I still think Canonical's making a big mistake forcing Unity down people's throat. GNOME shell people could probably learn to live with. Unity, it's kind of a either get on board with us or fuck off. It's there's no real in between there.
My biggest thing when it comes to Unity, I'm still using 11.04 on my Dell XPS. My biggest thing with it is it reminds me of like the transition from the Luna type UI from XP to going to Windows 7. You had that thing called Vista.
Yeah. That gives hope that, 2013, 2015, it will grow up into something you can live with.
I've beta tested, alpha tested, sorry, a little bit of 11.10. I haven't used it since the beta release, but it's hard to fault Canonical as a company. I mean, but they're a for-profit company at some point. It's hard to fault them for trying to do something different, when the open source community talks big and bad about, just take the code and run with it.
That's the thing. I've always looked on Canonical and Ubuntu as the Mac of Linux. I was absolutely certain that at some point down the road, they were going to kind of try and sell themselves as what Linux is. And what I'm deathly afraid of is at some point down the road, people are going to sit down in front of a Linux distro and expect it to behave like Unity and Ubuntu. I'm like, I don't want that. I like that we have GNOME, KDE, the Linux community does not want that. You do not want to be ingraining that expectation into the end user. It's good for Canonical and Ubuntu, but it's bad, in my opinion, for Linux as a whole.
I agree and disagree at the same point.
Well, it's bad for all of us who are in the KDE camp and like the widget-based way of doing things, because we'll just be screwed. If Canonical wants to do that, they need to learn to love KDE and teach everybody how to be KDE-ified. And it's,
well, you gotta remember, at least Unity 2D is based on Qt. You gotta give them that.
Yes.
So there is a little hope there. But, I just get sick of the hypocrisy of, like, you know, a company. It doesn't matter if it's Canonical, Novell, whatever, within the Linux community that goes and, you know, alters something or changes something, and they're like, oh my god, it's the end of the world. It's like, okay, you tell them to go ahead and repackage it, do what you want with it, then when they make a choice using that whole thing that we brag about as open source users, you sit there and bitch and moan about it. Okay.
You can't have it both ways is kind of one of the things that's been hawking around there. Anyways, getting back to the Microsoftian thing, the thing that more people are crying foul on this is if you read the license agreement for, you know, Windows 8 or the preliminary license agreement and so on, it's becoming pretty apparent that if you wanted to change the UI out, even if you hacked it in and did it, it's illegal. You're now in violation of the terms of service, and so basically they're pulling an Apple. There's in the same way Apple says, yes, you can only use OS X on Mac hardware. If you can get it to work on other hardware, then we're going to come hunt you down and throw you in jail for a violation. They don't really do that, but that's what their license agreement says. And it looks like Microsoft is going the same way. If you don't like the Windows 8 UI that basically turns your computer into a giant phone, and you don't like that particular thing, and if you try and hack around it and or change it, you are doing a crime, you know, so on and so forth. And that's just like, really, Microsoft? Really? So I guess they figured out that the problem with Windows Vista and Windows 7 and the people who complained about the UI is that they were allowed to complain. That if they make it part of their user agreement that they can't complain and they can't change it and they can't have any say about it, then they'll just accept it, right?
No, because when you tell people not to do something, they're going to do it anyway because you just told them not to. It's really what it ends up laying down to, because you're going to have people, like right now, on the Windows shell side of replacing stuff, you have, like, you know, a Talisman desktop for, you know, your, you know, purchase for shell replacements or whatever. But then you have, like, Shape Environment for, you know, the open source version. There's still going to be those people that are going to tweak, hack, break, fix, call it what you want.
Well, I'm kind of hoping with all the things Microsoft's doing in Windows 8 that I cannot make the final assessment on Windows 8 until I actually get my hands on it and play around with it. But it based on everything they're doing, I'm having real hesitations. I'm thinking Microsoft is hell-bent on creating another Vista. Because people are going to sit down in front of their brand new Windows 8 computer, and they're going to boot it up, and they're going to be confused.
And nothing works.
Yeah, they're going to be, things may work, but they're going to be confused. And when people get confused, they get annoyed and they get frustrated. And I see this all the time. The immediate reaction out of the average user, the moment they get confused, is, "Bishucks." You know, ever since Windows Vista, I'm seeing people who know nothing about technology, yada yada, because their old thing doesn't work on their new thing. They don't understand why. They don't care. They can't find the setting they learned 10 years ago over here, because it's been moved from here to here to here to here to there. It's like, and it's really funny. These people will sit down in front of OS X or Linux and accept that they have to learn because it isn't Windows. There's this instant mindset, it isn't Windows, so it's going to be different, so I have to learn. And as they learn, they're like, wow, this does this, wow, this does this, wow, this does this. You know, I prefer they sit down in front of Linux than OS X, but they just accept that. But Windows, on the other hand, they expect it to be Windows. So the moment Windows stops being Windows, which Windows is desperately trying not to be Windows, the instant reaction is, it sucks, and they move on. And I mean, it may cost them another 10% market share. Who knows?
I think it would do the computer industry good if it did. Personally.
Yep. Anyways, moving on to the other thing. Other. Wrong one. Okay. Lenovo's going to be selling Android tablets. Ooh, ah, yeah.
So it's just a ThinkPad, essentially.
No, it's going to be a 7-inch tablet. So it's Marcel would probably like these. Google is one of the companies, you know, getting the counterfeit certificate attack. So, of course, that's making news. Now this is interesting. There's rumors going around the interweb.
What a surprise.
Oh yeah. Oh my god, the blogosphere is tingling with the rumor of the thingy. Anyways, that because Google bought Motorola, and they now own all of that, and Motorola is expressing that they're not just interested in the patents, but they actually are interested in the hardware. Do we think the Nexus project is going to live again, and either at next year's I.O. or the I.O. after, you know, Google's going to be coming out and being very Apple-ish-like and going, here is our official flagship hardware, the Nexus whatever, and the yada yada. Like, they're going to reimagine the Zoom and do whatever they need to make it stick and reimagine the Nexus project and basically have a flagship phone and a flagship slate. Do we think they're really going to do that? If they do, do they think they'll get it right? Or do you think they'll...
Yeah, that's kind of a loaded question.
Well, I mean, they did kind of get... When the Nexus One was made, HTC made it, but Google went in there and basically micromanaged. They said, this is going to be the flagship Android phone. It's going to spread Android awareness. It's going to be on. And then, after taking all that micromanaging and going in there and making it the best Android phone it could be and making sure stock Android was on there and all the settings were right and it was a good phone and good quality and good everything and good interface, they then made the only way you could buy it was to get a Google Checkout account and go to Google.com. So...
Okay, here's what I think they're going to do. If you've looked at how they, I wouldn't say worked with previous, you know, Nexus type hardware manufacturers or whatever, you look at what they've done. You know, you go from like the G1, you know, the very first Google Android phone.
Yeah, I have that, and why I love it, and it has a good design, and it's good. Anybody who's owned a G1 will acknowledge that what HTC essentially did when they made the G1 was they looked at the minimum operating specs for Android and then cut them in half.
But, you know, you take the G1, then you look at what we have now for the Android, you know, phones, tablets, whatever, and it's just like, it's night and day. But if you look at the progression in the history of it, it's like, okay, the first set of Android phones, underpowered, and that's being polite. It took until about late 2009 when like the original Droid came out before people were like, oh, okay, we actually have to put like iPhone specs with this.
You know? Actually, the Droid, if we're honest, was basically 150 to 170% the iPhone specs. And that's kind of the model that's been going alongside. Now the iPhone has caught up to the higher end Android specs.
Yeah. You know, that's the point, though. It's always been, there's like these milestones that Google has laid out. It's like, okay, this is the kind of hardware you need to be putting this on. You know, trying to guide it. With them buying Motorola, I think Eric Schmidt put his foot in his mouth again, personally. Oh, we bought the hardware, too.
Well, remember, Eric Schmidt isn't in charge of Google anymore. He's the other guy.
Yeah, but he's...
He's now the PR guy.
Yeah, exactly. That's the problem. Putting your foot in your mouth as the PR guy is not exactly a great place to be.
It's better than doing it as the CEO.
Almost. The problem with it is you have Larry Page, who's the current CEO. He's like, oh yeah, we're buying them because of the patents, more or less. It is essentially what he said in, you know, the Google blog or whatever announcing it. Then you have your PR guy, who used to be the CEO, was like, oh yeah, we bought them because we want the hardware too.
Well, as always, Google's left hand and Google's right hand, I have a bit of a Jekyll and Hyde syndrome.
And I think, personally, you're going to get, if anything, while Motorola will still be, you know, they'll be a hardware company, and Google is essentially just buying the patents because, from what I'm, you know, from seeing how Larry Page is anyway, he's more of, you know, he's like Sergey Brin in that regard. You know, he's more about programming and, you know, open source and that kind of stuff.
Well, and see, that.
I think it's going to be a lot more reference designs. You know, this is what.
Basically, this is what we want, now everybody else go clone it.
Yeah. We don't care what you do, but this is where it's going
to
go.
Well, no, and see, that goes into. Honestly, when it comes. I love hardware, but when it comes to hardware, you know, you're seeing all the hardware right now, and people are just getting a few things, like, not quite right. I mean, on these phones, they should have 512 to a gig of memory. They should have a gigahertz, ideally dual-core gigahertz. They should be basically a little portable computing device, so they're actually capable of doing high-end stuff. They should offer it subsidized and unsubsidized, and it should be Qualcomm, so it can move back and forth between LTE, CDMA, and GSM. You know, so they can make some. Nobody's going to make that phone, but that's the phone I'd want. Same thing with the slates. I like the Zoom overall, but it's not quite enough system. It should have a 2 gigs of RAM instead of the gig, and it should not be a 16:9 display. It should be a 16:10 display, so when I am using that thing as what they seem to be turning into, media consumption device, I have room for the controls around the video as opposed to the sun. But it's because really a 16:9 is a little too sun. A 16:10, you'd be good for work and play. But, you know, it's, I don't know. The industry seems to disagree.
Yeah, well, the industry got a lot of stuff wrong.
And then again, I don't think laptops should be 16:9, and I've said that several times. I'm just, no.
Yeah, I can't say much. I just got a 4x3, actually.
Where did you find a 4x3 laptop?
It's an older ThinkPad.
Okay. See, that's the thing. Do you know how many I just want to get work done people are going and buying 5-year-old ThinkPads because they want a 4x3 screen, and that's the best system they can get that has a 4x3 screen? They're buying the high-end 5-year-old ThinkPads that have...
Yeah, for like $250 now.
Yeah, that have like a... basically, they're buying Duo systems. And they're paying the same price you would pay for a brand new Duo system to get that 4x3 screen.
Yep.
With less memory, and usually they're unless you can get somebody to part with the few that are serial ATA, they're IDE hard drives.
Yes. I ended up going with a T60P because it was a Core 2 Duo, so it was a legitimate dual core.
Right, the Centrino 2 technology.
Yeah, it's, you know, I upgraded to 4 gigs of, at that time, it would have been high and
deep. Yeah, that's like an 8 gig system today.
So it was like, you know, a high-end DDR2 4 gigs.
Oh, and that would be the one that actually had the, is that 800 or is that the 533?
That's the 800. I got the P series, so I got the dedicated graphics card and
right.
I got the whole shebang. When I shop for what I want, I get what I want. But I made sure it was the 14-inch model with, you know, the 4x3 screen and blah 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 blah.
The only bad thing about that one is it's a T-Series, so you have the useless thumb reader.
Yeah, well, there's not much I can do about that. It's kind of on the machine.
Yeah, I know. Well, it's, again, I don't understand why... I actually called Lenovo up the other day. I said, okay, I know you don't sell the 4x3 screens because you're retards, but is it possible to buy a ThinkPad that does not have the useless thumb reader? Because that was the best thing about the R series. It was the T series, but it was cheaper because it didn't have the thumb reader that does absolutely nothing to protect your computer.
Well, it's like right now I'm looking at my Dell, my XPS. It's got a thumb reader. I'm like, I don't use it.
Well, and they're worthless. Because even if you use them and put your thing in our sun, by the time I get to the point where I'm putting my thumb or a finger or something for a biometric thing, that means I have physical access to the machine. If I want to break into your machine, what I'm going to do is take the hard drive out of it and plug it into something else. I have physical access to the machine. You cannot stop me. I'm just saying, you know, it's a great marketing gimmick, but it's worthless.
It is. I agree.
Okay.
It gives a false sense of security.
Which is even worse, actually. That's like all the Mac people walking around thinking they can't get viruses so they don't exercise common sense.
Well, the same could be said to all the people who are running Linux boxes that don't run at all either.
Oh no, I agree with that, but one thing I'm starting to see in a lot of the user-friendly versions of Linux is they're coming with shortcut links on the desktop that say firewall, and so, you know, they're incentivizing, hey dumbass, you're not secure. And that's the right behavior to be incentivizing. No false sense of immunity, you're as vulnerable as everyone else. Well, not as vulnerable, but you know what I mean.
You're more vulnerable to things like, you're still vulnerable to being an idiot, like, you know, phishing, or you're still, you know, running a RPM from an untrusted source, or dev from an untrusted source, or blah, 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 blah.
Or even executing a shell installer or something, you know?
Yeah, just being a moron. I mean, the problem is not the core computer. It doesn't matter if it's Windows, Linux, or OS X. The problem is from the keyboard to the chair.
Exactly. And if that little bit isn't doing what it should, the computer is lost.
Exactly.
Okay.
Next story.
Yeah. Well, this one, I'm hesitant.
No.
Is it? Yeah. Tell him to call. Just call him.
Yeah, I gotta
at
the conference.
Sorry about that.
Way to wake up, jackass.
Yeah, we've been going for about 40 minutes now.
I'm just AFK, I'm sorry.
Yeah, AFK,
my friend. Okay, partner Bob.
You were sent an email, you were sent Skype messages, I did everything but Google Plus you.
This never happened in Windows.
Yeah, sure, but not Windows.
Yeah, just so you realize, you sound like you're 50 feet away.
Well, that means I'm moving around.
Ah. For those of you, if you can't hear Commodore, blame him.
It's all Commodore's fault.
That's right. It's not my fault. For once, the audio problems are not my fault. They're
not
his fault.
It was my fault. Now it's his fault.
What if I move my mic around? Are we doing this now? Are we live?
We've been live.
Oh. Okay, what have we been talking about?
Well, we're down to Google at this point.
Oh.
Am unless you have any just what the F thoughts on the T-Mobile merger or the Apple Gestapo.
The what?
I think that
was
a no.
I think that
was
a no.
I guess not.
Anyways, moving into the Google Plus-dom, unless you have any more thoughts on... No, we've covered that. Never mind. See, I'm hesitant to give any credit to G Plus right now at all. I don't like some of the things Google are doing. You know,
it's more like
Twitter if it were run by Facebook. That's really what G Plus is. G Plus is Twitter if it were run by Facebook. If the Zucker Pope had made Twitter, that's G Plus. they're doing some things, and you know, it's closed again. And because it's closed, the mobile version doesn't work. And I know it doesn't work, because if you try and go to the mobile version on an Android phone, it basically, if you try and go to a Google Plus stream on the mobile phone, it tells you that nothing is available because you're not signed into G Plus.
Is that using the Google Plus app, though, or is that using the web?
It's trying to use the web page, and the app won't really, and the app won't work unless you have a Google Plus account.
Interesting.
Because here's the thing: on the desktop, I can go to somebody's Google Plus profile and see all of their public posts, even if I don't have a Google Plus account.
Is that all better?
Anyways, moving on from Commodore's.
Anyway. Sorry about that.
But on the phone, if I try and do that, I get redirected to an m.google page that tells me they haven't shared anything with me, and it won't display the public posts. And because Google is closed right now, they can't sign up. And if they don't already have a Google Plus account, they can't sign in with the Google Plus app. So basically, Google Plus, its latest glitch is it doesn't work at all with mobile. Unless you are one of the few people who got in before Google shut it down. Or you were invited by somebody who was in and signed. But I'm like, you know, once again, it has become the anti-social, social whatever. But, you know, to hear Schmidt, it's an ID service, so I guess it's not supposed to be social, you know.
So why is it bad to invite only where you can get it from, you know, it's closed and, you know, it's just,
They say they got overloaded, but basically they're going through the same thing. You remember when they first launched Gmail? You know, it was, we have these select VIP people who have a Gmail account with 2 gig of storage, which I think it's now 7.5, but, you know, the 2 gig was a big thing back then, because you had to, like, kill somebody to get 100 megabytes back when Google did that.
Yeah, they've given them away.
Yeah, then they got overloaded. So then they reduced it to private invite only. And then when the private invites ran out, you know, people were like, I need more. Then they gave more private invites. And then it eventually became, okay, it's still in beta, but anybody can go to it. And that seems to be the same cycle they're taking G Plus through. There's a lot of features missing with Google Plus. It doesn't sync quite like it should. Right now, the mobile version is not accessible properly. And the biggest complaint I have about it is it's Google. So the idea behind it is we want this to be your master ID for the internet. Basically, to use the internet, you have to use this Google ID and this Google ID.
Oh, it's like a social security number.
Yeah, they want it to be your internet SS. Okay, fine. But the pros and cons to that, but it hopefully people are going into that eyes open instead of naive as all hell. But what has me concerned about that is people, especially when it comes to online, they have more than one nom de plume. You know, like online, I am the alias I have created, I'm the show that sucks, and I am 2 companies. So, obviously, if I'm going to really use these, and I wanted to use Google, and with Google Plus, I could, you know, I could create circles for each one of these modes of mine, and, you know, share stuff with this circle, and that circle, and I could execute all these modes from one thing. But there is no blah blah slash blah blah thing native to the Google system. And while you can get one with G+.2, you know, TO, you can only get one per ID.
Oh, you mean like your vanity URL, like the Facebook search?
Yeah.
I can make a Facebook.com/convert256, but then I have to give up my my cell phone number.
Exactly.
But I don't have one, so I can't make one.
Well, and I mean, you could go to google.to and put in your G+ ID and get g+.to/whatever pseudonym you want to be known by. You know, like you would be Connie Dore. But see, I, in my case, I'd need at least four of those, realistically five. And you're only allowed one per ID. So basically, I mean, I don't want to be sending people I'm in a business relationship with to blah blah slash the show that sucks. And likewise, I don't want to be sending the show that sucks people to the business feed and so on and so forth. Now,
yes, we all wear masks, metaphorically speaking.
Oh, okay, Ben Stein.
that should be one of our soundboards.
Yeah, we need to sit down and write all the things we need on a soundboard, because we need so many of those. We definitely need the transparent aluminum. But
anyway, back to the Google.
Yeah. I don't know. It's you don't want to go online by your legal name in all places. Really, the only times you're doing that is in a business relationship. At all other times, you're going by various pseudonyms.
You know, it's like one of those things like, oh, okay, Joe Smith, oh, he was drunk at a party one time. It's like, no, that's not the same Joe Smith that, you know, that did your investment banking, you know?
Well, and then that becomes the rush for who gets blah blah slash Joe Smith. I'm Joe Smith, blah 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 blah. I mean, what do you add?
I'm saying there's people that, like, carry all their lives online, but different portions of their lives. They put everything in one shoebox, basically.
Well, and that's what the circles would let you sort that, but you still want to be giving the different shoeboxes to different people as part of the sorting.
I guess, but
I just hope if Google adds a thing like this where it's like slash such and such, and you have, like, all the John Smiths wanting slash John Smith, they don't go, oh, well, it's very simple. All you have to do is your slash is now John Smith slash your birthday. So now not only do they have your name, but they have your date of birth.
Great. And then they can steal your identity.
Oh, they can steal your identity with just your name, but especially if you're in certain industries, it gets real easy. And more places than I care to acknowledge, if you're legal, you're required to have a license with the state, and the state gives your social security number out when somebody inquires after your license.
Great. That sounds real secure.
Anyway.
Put the tinfoil hat on.
Like I said, name.
No tinfoil hat involved.
Yeah, that's not theory, that's fact. It's alarming fact, but it's fact.
But you're just being paranoid.
Yeah.
Okay, for the last story, do we want to go into, you know, we're getting into Google being evil, actually. This is now the Google be evil segment.
It's like the whole 1984 thing, like Apple trying to prevent Big Brother, but they became Big Brother. It's like
and Google didn't want to be evil by becoming the mother of all evil.
Exactly.
Okay, do we care about the 10 companies Google closed?
Which ones?
It's like stuff they bought or stuff... In the words of their new CEO... Google is deciding to invest productively, which, you know, it's like I said, and I said this a while ago, we don't have to worry about Google as long as Google is being crazy Google. When they're doing things like dedicating a floor of their building to being the world's largest Plinko machine and just doing it because they can, we don't have to worry about Google. We start worrying about Google when they get to the point where they start bean counting.
Yeah,
Google has officially reached the point that they are bean counting, and that's the official statement from their CEO. We have determined that just being goofy Google is not cost effective, so we're not going to be goofy Google anymore. We're going to close things that aren't profitable, regardless of how many people are dependent on them, or that aren't profitable enough, or that we think are conflict with other projects we have going on, you know.
So I bet we wish that we had Schmidt back, huh?
What was that you said, Bob?
I didn't say a damn thing.
No, I bet you wish we had Schmidt back.
Oh, I heard what you said, Kami. I thought Bob said something in response to that. I don't know. I want Google to obey its company line of don't be evil, instead of how can we be evil today? Some of the things Google's doing lately makes me think of Snidely.
What?
You've obviously never watched Hanna-Barbera cartoons.
Oh, man, that makes me feel old.
I don't remember them. It's been years, man. All right.
You don't know who's... Oh, man. I feel old now.
I know who you mean.
He had the wacky races. He had the 00 car. Come on, man.
Oh, he's basically that dude, that stereotypical 1920s dude that tied one of the railroad tracks and, like, had them run over. That basically what he looks like. Mustache.
How does it feel to feel old, Bob?
I know that feeling.
The sad part is I'm not much older than Commodore, but I still know what you're talking about.
See, there's this thing. There's like this in our generation, there's this, if somebody's like 2 or 3 years younger than you, they miss the boat on so many things.
Yeah.
Anyways, okay. Last bit. No. Y'all missed so much. I mean, you don't remember the '80s 1.0, so you're actually looking forward to the '80s 2.0 instead of running in fear and hiding in under your bed from it like the rest of us are.
Thinking like it was gonna be a nuclear bomb.
The Russians. The evil Russians.
Anyways, okay, moving on to the last Google Be Evil thing. Google has been gamed, but unlike being gamed for, you know, spamish search results and all the other ways Google has been gamed in the past, Google has been gamed now into basically reporting that millions of small businesses have closed their doors. But these small businesses are all still open for business.
Google's page rankings all screwed up.
Yeah, when you go in Google Places and so forth, you know, the thing that does the Google Earth search, like if I search for pizza right now, it'll tell me all the pizza places that are around me, especially if I do it on my Android phone.
But they're out of business, huh?
Well, okay, but there's a feedback thing in there where you can, like, say, oh, this place is closed, oh, they suck. You know, you can do reviews or you can report problems. And one of the problems you can report is that this is an outdated result and the place is closed. So what were some unscrupulous competitors doing? They were reporting all their competitors as closed, so they are the default number one result. And Google was acquiescing to their request and letting themselves be gamed and basically basically removing millions of small businesses from the directory as permanently closed.
So there's really no way to undo that, is there?
Well,
their phone numbers better start calling.
But basically they have to go through reapply and yada yada, and you know that process takes upwards of 2 weeks. So basically they're not findable for 2 weeks, and then they'll get gamed again, and then they're not findable for another 2 weeks, another 2 weeks, and it's like,
I don't know. If you could prove it, you're doing it, you could probably get some suit or something, but there's really no way to prove it.
How do you prove that? How do you prove which one of your unscrupulous competitors, like, I know it's that evil bastard down the street who doesn't like me because I'm better than him?
Or, well, anyway, there's no way to prove it, though, you know, but whatever.
Well, and honestly, the only way I know to fix this would be Google needs to change their policy. In that before they remove them like this, because when you apply for Google Places, Google sends you a postcard that basically...
Oh, okay, so basically they'll send them a postcard. Are you really out of business?
Yeah, and basically if they don't reply in 30 days, then they get removed. Like, they'll send them a postcard and go, you have been reported as closed. Please enter this code within the next 30 days or your listing will be removed. Google needs to do that so they don't get gamed. Because short of doing that, there's no way to prevent this. But they should not be removing people that are still open for business because their unscrupulous competitors are trying to get them gone. Unless y'all can think of a better solution to that.
That's a perfect solution.
That's a good solution.
Why didn't Google think of that?
Because it's Google. They're engineers.
This is what happens when you fill
a
room.
God must be an engineer. Who else would put a waste management center right next to a recreation plant? Or a waste management plant next to a recreation center?
Oh, that's wrong.
You should be slapped.
Is there nobody at Google who knows human factors? And more importantly, why is human factors so counterproductive? I've never understood why human factors is a degree. Shouldn't everybody understand human factors?
They should, but they don't.
They're not human. They're machines. That's Skynet. They're going to take over.
Well, and designers hate working for Google. Designers are like people who are really good at human factors, but designers hate working for Google because they're dealing with 50 engineers. They hired this great designer at one point to try and, you know, spruce up some of the Google stuff. And when his confidentiality thing clause, you know, he started publishing articles about, I'm never, ever, ever going to do that again. You know, you micromanage every little thing. Should a border be 1 pixel or 5? If they decide they like blue, they'll put 256 shades of blue and hold studies and polls on which one to pick. Just pick one and move on.
Yeah, that's where engineers should be put, you know?
Almost sounds like canonical.
That had crossed my mind. That's what canonical is. Canonical is this weird hybridization of Google being evil and Apple being Macintosh. Isn't that what canonical is? I mean, tell me I'm wrong.
No, somebody prove us wrong.
And you can
I mean,
prove canonical. Us wrong, put the source for canonical sun. Yeah, yeah. Oh. Is there anything else we want to go into or anything you want to rehash? Late with the Commodore. We covered that Bob comes from the net.
I do.
And anybody who's old enough to get that reference, join in with us. Anybody who has no idea what we're talking about, I'm sorry you don't understand the sideways square yin-yang signs. I bet you half the people watching this have no idea what we're talking about with Bob.
I too can name a planet that.
Say what?
Nothing. Well, then you don't have to live on my planet.
Stop the drugs, you're pure energy.
Well, no, that's why you chose Bob. I'm thinking of the other Bob.
Oh, okay.
Bob.
You know, he came from the net. That was what he said. My name is Bob. I come from the net. Best geek show ever. Or definitely one of the top three. Name me one that's better.
What about Freakazoid? He was like sucked into the internet.
Not even in the same league. Cute but funny, but not even in the same league.
Oh, man. Oh, come on. The dude's cat kept typed on the keyboard, and he typed in backspace. All right. Anyway, maybe we should just, like, stop right here and just go on or whatever.
Well, we've covered everything. Like I said, unless there's something you want to go back into. Because this show is just so off kilter, neither one of you have videos on, you know, I just said, the official title for this show is going to suck. So anybody who's stuck around has nobody to blame but themselves.
It's all self-inflicted pain.
You masochist.
Oh, yeah.
Guys,
It's bound to be a bad show every now and then. Before it gets completely ridiculously and awful, though, we're going to pause it, or stop. So, everybody say goodbye, Net.
Goodbye, Net.
I'm going to go to sleep on the net again. Bye.